Hey there, and welcome to the Vassals of Kingsgrave video game edition. In this podcast, we'll be chatting about all things gaming and ranking some of our favorite titles of all time. My name is Duncan, or Valkyrist on the forums, and joining me today is...
Hi, this is Zach. I go by Alias on the forums.
Hi, this is Katie, Lady Griffin on the forums.
This is Bing, Shushine on the forums.
Greetings, mortals. This is Patrick, Patrick the Toll is on the forums.
Hey, this is Paul, Sir Dinneral on the forums.
This is Adam, Drone hey. Snow on the forums.
Hey, it's Hannah, Shadow Baby on the forums.
Great. Well, thanks for coming on, guys. So as I mentioned on the forums, I haven't been doing as much gaming over the past couple of years. I don't own any of the current gen consoles, for example. However, I still really love reading about the new games and the classic games and getting recommendations. So I guess just to start out the conversation, I wanted to go around the group and maybe people could talk about what kind of gamer they are, what kind of games they usually like to play, or what they're playing at the moment. Zach, would you like to start?
Sure. As far as what kind of gamer I am, I think that I am pretty ubiquitous in the types of games I like. I like a lot of different stuff. I've played console games, I've played PC games, and I'm a big fan of all things video games, so I have a lot of experience with many things. But if I had to pick a couple of genres that I normally gravitate to, it'd probably be RTS and RPGs.
So, forgive my ignorance, RTS is like strategy games where you're moving units across the field and fighting each other.
So real-time strategy, yeah. So it's where the action is constantly happening, and it is one of those sort of like bird's-eye view strategy games where you build and move units and things like that.
So like Age of Empires?
Where you that counts, and I've played plenty of that as well.
I remember I would often try to build the empire, and I kept getting attacked, and I was more interested in actually creating things than fighting the opponent, which usually ended in death.
True.
Is there a particular game you're playing at the moment that you're enjoying?
Normally, most of the time I'm playing a few games like as a staple, and I'll branch out to more, single-player story-based games. So the games I play like all the time that I'm still currently playing a lot are like League of Legends and Overwatch and StarCraft. So those are the games that I'm just playing all the time. And Overwatch is a shooter game that Blizzard just came out with. StarCraft RTS game. League of Legends is a MOBA, which is kind of like an RTS, but you only play one character, and it's a PvP game.
Okay, cool. Katie, what sorts of games do you like to play?
I'm kind of like Zach in that I'm pretty ubiquitous. I usually don't dabble, however, in anything that has multiplayer or online elements with playing with other people. I'm a strictly console person, so no PC for me. And I guess if I had like one specific genre I'm really attached to, it'd definitely be RPG games, especially BioWare stuff. And if I'm honest, like if my list was completely honest, it would just be all BioWare games for 1 through 5, but I limited myself to just one. And right now I just finished The Witcher 3 DLC Blood and Wine, which was really excellent. And I just picked up or I just purchased Inside, which is the new game by Playdead, who are the people who did Limbo.
And was there also a Witcher podcast that's coming out, possibly?
Yeah, we recorded it a while ago, and I put off editing it because I kind of wanted to do a coda where we talked about the DLC because I liked Blood and Wine so much. So yeah, it'll be out eventually.
Yeah, we could still do that.
Yeah, we could do that eventually. I might just separate, because the one we did was really, really long, so I might just end up separating them into two different podcasts.
Sure. Bing, what about you?
Yeah, so... First of all, I only almost exclusively game on my PC since I don't actually own that many consoles. And most of the games I play are generally strategy games, grand strategies like Crusader Kings and Europa Universalis, which I'll talk about, and, I don't know, turn-based strategies. I also dabble a little bit in RPGs, primarily for BioWare games, but these days I don't have that much time to sink all my time into it, unfortunately.
Yeah, gaming, that's kind of one of the reasons I haven't played as much games as I used to. I still really enjoy it, but it does take up a lot of time. Like even just a single player can take up 20, 30 hours more if you want to sort of collect everything.
And especially with BioWare games, you sink into the story and you can't stop. So, unfortunately.
I haven't really. I've played the Mass Effect games, but I haven't played the Dragon Age, but I do want to check them out.
What?
Dragon Age?
I remember playing a demo of the second one, but it didn't really.
It's worth it.
It was a bit of a hack and slash, which isn't really my favorite genre.
What?
Katie is so upset.
Well, maybe
we'll get to that.
Maybe
we'll
that'll
get to
come
that.
Up in the main discussion.
The games I'm playing right now, it's just, I think I'm playing Civ 5 in preparation for the release of Civ 6 this month.
My man.
my man.
Yeah.
That's exciting. And
there's this new towers sim game called Project High Rise that just came out, which I also played a little bit.
Patrick, what about you? What are you playing at the moment? Or what do you enjoy?
Well, the type of gamer I am, I'm more like a mix between the person that's really focused on the storytelling, the narrative games. So I usually play games that are really strong, maybe have a very linear story. But I also like to branch into games that have like collecting methods, like Pokemon and stuff like that. Right now, for example, I'm playing Pokemon and Fallout 4 and Civilization 5. So it's a bit, I'm all over the place, but usually the ones I enjoy the most are the grindy games or the games with a really, really like focused narrative game on it. So one of my favorite games is Morrowind, just because it has like strong narrative, but it has a lot of grindiness to it as well. So I guess
the perfect synthesis.
Whenever I think of grinding, I think of that South Park episode where they're playing World of Warcraft. Yep. And they go into the woods for 12 months to kill goats to level up.
It's boars, actually. They kill boars.
And it's just this montage of them killing boars and growing bigger and bigger.
It's a classic.
Yeah.
Ugh.
Yeah. Paul, what about you?
I got to side with Patrick on that. I usually play games which are very heavily narrative-based. If it's got a good story, I'm behind it no matter what genre it is. And then I also like to delve into RTS games, like, of course, Civ 5. And usually I'll also tend to play multiplayer games with my friends, like Overwatch and stuff like that. And then also in preparation for the new Star Wars movie, I've gotten back into Star Wars Empire at War. And I found a good mod called Thrawn's Revenge, and it makes the game a lot more enjoyable. You get a lot more factions. The ships look a bit more to scale. So, yeah, that's basically what I've been doing.
Cool. Adam?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not really into, like, super puzzle games or anything like that, I guess. But I kind of play a mix of everything, at least I used to. I don't play as much as I used to. Let's see, like, a couple weeks ago, I got Planet Base. It was, like, on sale on Steam, and that was, I actually sunk quite a few hours into that recently. I'm always kind of playing Hearthstone on and off. Lately, I spend a lot of time playing Lego games because of my son. So my son is kind of my video game time now. Mm-hmm. So there's my pile of shame is just kind of stacked to the wall, it feels like now.
Well, those games are pretty good.
Like, I never even finished Grand Theft Auto 4, you know, much less 5. Like, stuff like that, it's like, whatever, you know. So.
Right. At least those Lego games are pretty fun, though. So.
Yeah, they are. And I'm like, for a 4-year-old, the fact that he could do most of the stuff in them is, I don't know. I feel like at 4 years old, I couldn't have done a lot of that. So.
Great. And Hannah, what about you?
So what type of gamer I am is mostly a gamer from the past. I played a lot of video games when I was a kid. And through my teenage years, but I had my son at 20, and then I went to college, so I haven't had a lot of time for it. So I play a lot of cartridge games. We still have a Super Nintendo that we play. Games that I've been in recently, I'm just like Adam, our son started playing Minecraft and kind of got us cracked out on it, and we have this one survival game where we're playing, and basically I went down to Bedrock and hollowed out like 3/4 of the map. We have a million resources.
Not sure that's possible. Those maps are huge.
It's just like, yeah, no, it's really insane. We put a bunch of nether, like, I don't go in the nether. All I care about is mining. So I just went down. I built like a spiral staircase from the surface to bedrock. They built a castle on top of it, and they go to the nether and they get me a bunch of netherrack, and I laugh. Fire for torches everywhere, and we just stay up all night doing that.
I guess for me, I'm more of like a Nintendo gamer. I've had all the Nintendo consoles since the Super Nintendo, so I'm really into platforming. So I love Super Mario games, the Donkey Kong games. In terms of what I'm playing at the moment, I have a bunch of games that I'm like a third of the way through and I just sort of never got back to. So I'm about a third of the way through Darksiders 2. Because someone told me it was a lot like Zelda, like an action-adventure, but it's more sort of a God of War kind of hack and slash game, which it's fun, but it's sort of not really my kind of game. I did buy a couple of games last week. I bought Journey, Beyond Good and Evil, so I'm going to try and get to them at some point.
Excellent. It's both really good.
Yeah, I heard they're really
Beyond Good and Evil, long-awaited sequel, hopefully, eventually, at some point.
They just announced that.
Did they really?
Officially, like 2 days ago, Polygon put out an article.
Yeah, I find myself sort of more interested in like looking sort of at retro games, games that I might have missed, and independent games are sort of attractive too, because they're not necessarily these huge sprawling things. You can sort of, they're a bit smaller. Sort of like Braid. I played Braid a couple of years ago, and that was really fun. There's another question here. I think, Zach, you had it. Do you watch games more than you play them on YouTube and Twitch?
Yeah, I'm curious about this, because obviously these platforms have grown in popularity a lot recently, and they've become a way for a lot of people to experience games even in full with the Let's Plays on YouTube and the Twitch playthroughs. So is that something that people find themselves doing a lot?
Yes.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah. Yep.
It saves a lot of time.
Well, not more
than I play? No.
Yeah, exactly. Not more than I play. I only use it for times when I can't actually sit with a keyboard and mouse in my hand. For example, if I'm sitting with my son or something and I have to use some time, I can watch a playthrough of something, but mostly I'm just playing.
Yeah, but if you get stuck somewhere and you know, it's like, I don't have an hour to hunt something down and I want to look
I never get
a playthrough, now it's nice. So. Of course you don't.
I never get stuck, ever.
I mostly use it to watch games that like the Uncharted games or the Last of Us, which is just so story focused that it seems like watching movies. So
Uncharted, you get something more out of it.
Uncharted is so close to a movie that you could just watch it. Yeah.
And you get to hear someone else's reactions and kind of experience it with them too, so that adds something also.
Yeah, I usually do it for games that I feel like have kind of a culture around them, but I'm too lazy to actually play myself, so. I use Giant Bomb a lot because I just like the personality of the staff there, and I watch them play the entire Metal Gear Solid series rather than just play them myself. I'm like, I'm never going to play Metal Gear. But so that was nice. I was like, someone is doing this chore for me so that I can be in the conversation.
I'm the same way because I just love to see people's kind of reactions in general to plot lines and things like that. So I'll watch people like Jesse Cox or Dodger and... catch them with them, and some I also kind of have enjoyed the Yogg's Cast, if anyone knows them. They're a British group of guys. They've made a channel where basically it's just a bunch of them get together and play Civ, and you get to watch them slowly descend into madness and hatred for each other by like invading each other's countries over the littlest things.
I think I've seen that. It's good.
Yeah. As we get to talking about our favorite games, like one of the things I love to do is watch as many playthroughs as I can of other people playing my favorite story games. I love just watching how different people react to some of my favorite games. So
I love watching people play the Telltale games, especially. Like, I know that those games have kind of come under heat because once you peel back the curtain, they're not. They're very flawed products, but they also, I think, some of the best reaction videos I've ever watched have come from watching people. Like struggle over some of the choices in those games.
Yeah, this isn't Telltale, but I must have watched like 5 or 6 playthroughs of Life is Strange in the past year, so it's the same.
Oh my gosh! Yeah.
Yes, those are the games that are conducive to just watching because they're so story focused and dependent upon like sort of reactions at certain spoiler points.
Nowadays, they build games kind of that way, right? Very cinematic, sort of. You know, some of them are just basically on rails, you know, but you don't notice it. And it's a good watch as much as it is a good play. But, you know, as a kid growing up, you had a game and one controller, and so you'd have to watch. And so the games that were actually entertaining to watch, those were kind of the best games. Because, if I'm not playing for an hour, like, I'm still having fun.
Yeah, sometimes you just get annoyed when watching people playing games because they feel like they're so ineffective in doing them, inefficient. So when I think you can just go over there, you don't have to walk around and look for buttons and whatever. You just go over there. Why are you doing this?
Why waste your time on the inferior people, right, Patrick?
I would be so bad doing one of those playthroughs. I'm like so pedantic. I just have to search like every nook and cranny. It would take like 50 hours to beat a game.
Yeah, because that's kind of one of the problems, because I've been watching a Witcher playthrough with Jesse Cox, and he literally has episodes on YouTube that are just called Jesse Cox looks for fucking loot, deal with it.
Yeah,
and,
yeah, like, Duncan, he's like, the exact same.
He's basically like you, Duncan, where he'll put up an episode, and at the beginning he's like, now I know all of you are going to get really mad at me because I'm not doing the story, but I heard about this chest that's hidden over here, and I'm pretty sure there's other loot there. So I'm going to this really discreet corner of the map, and it's like an hour-long episode of him just looting everything.
That's what, well, I mean, that's kind of one of the first things I do when I play a new game is, like, I try and find the invisible wall, so I sort of map out where, what the extent of the game is. So a game like Fallout, it just drives me insane because it is so big. Like, I did end up clocking that game, but it took so long. Just trying to find everything
not,
secret. It makes you crazy.
You're not allowed to play open world games anymore, Duncan.
You know, I just feel like, games especially that I know are big, and I'm like, it's going to take me like 10 years to do this. So I just wait till it's like $5 or something, you know, and then I'm like, it can sit on the shelf until I get to it.
I feel that way about the Persona games, because they're way too long and very grindy. Yep.
JRPG at its highest form. Endless grind, endless story.
Mm-hmm. Very frustrating dialogues that are, you feel like they're poorly translated, so they go on about 20 times longer than they need to be. Information gets repeated in about 5 different formats.
Okay, well, I think we're ready to move on to our main discussion. So, as we mentioned, we'll be listing some of our favorite games of all time. Hosts will take turns unveiling each of their picks and talk a bit about why they love it so much. So we've each selected 5 games, meaning there can be up to 5 rounds, depending on whether there's enough time. There are quite a few participants. Any preference on who goes first? Should we just keep the order that I've got here and keep making Zach go first?
I trust Zach.
Are we doing them one at a time? Is that how it's?
Yeah, that's the idea. So one at a time.
Is it in a particular order? I thought maybe we were just going to like list our 5 and talk about one. Or something,
no, I haven't ranked them. I've just picked 5.
Okay.
Talk about them in any order you want. Yeah.
Sure. So my first pick, and I recognize that this is a bit of a risky pick because I just got into this game and this game series in the past 3 or 4 months or so. And with these like favorite top 10, top 5 game things, you want to let it germinate a bit. But this is the first time in a long time that I really, really just fell in love with a game and a game series and just completely got absorbed by it. It's been a while since I had this kind of reaction to a game. And my pick is Dark Souls. So this is a little funny because on the last video game roundtable, I recall being skeptical of Vikram kind of talking about Dark Souls and Dark Souls 2 and saying like, oh, that's not really the type of game for me. I'm not a big action sort of fighty kind of player, but now like I got into it this past year because my little brother was such a big fan and he really wanted me to play it, and I completely fell into the experience. I played all of the games in the series. So there's Demon's Souls, which is the first game. I played that. I played Dark Souls 3 times at this point. I played Dark Souls 2 twice, Dark Souls 3 twice, Dark Souls 3 being the latest in the series that just came out this year, and I've played Bloodborne as well. So I've played like hundreds of hours of these games. Yeah, all in the last few months. I've been completely hooked on these games. So for those who don't know, Dark Souls is a action RPG released by From Software, a Japanese company, renowned for their difficulty. That is the big sort of rallying cry around Dark Souls, is that they're very difficult. But also, and this is the thing that I love, they are very well designed in terms of the world. Dark Souls, the first one in particular, has a very cohesive map. Everything fits together so nicely, and it's just a joy to progress through it. And it, like, just every piece of the mechanics of the progression is tooled so well that you're learning every time you die. Because, of course, another thing about it is that you die a lot as you're fighting the enemies and the bosses throughout. And I just, you know, just something about that gameplay loop was so satisfying to me. You know, every time you overcome that challenge, every time you can beat that big boss, it's such a high. And I haven't gotten that high, especially in a single-player game, in a long time. And it was definitely like a revelatory experience, and that's why it makes the top 5 for me.
Yeah, Bloodborne is a beautiful game.
Yeah, Bloodborne is aesthetically gorgeous. It has a amazing sort of design to it with this sort of, I don't know how you describe it. How would you describe it, Katie?
It's like cemetery Victorian, like very super, super, super gothic and kind of body horror-ish, I guess.
Yeah.
It's almost like the Japanese version of gothic. You know, you've seen like Baby Metal and whatever. It's always over the top.
those games are also pretty cool in that their stories are kind of hidden almost. Like, you kind of have to go hunting to find the context clues of the narrative that's driving it. But Bloodborne especially, I didn't really enjoy playing it, but I loved discovering the story of Yharnam and how fucked up that city is and the blood disease. And it's just a really awesome, beautiful universe.
Yeah, that's the other piece of it that's so interesting is that I guess you might call it like emergent storytelling in much the same way that people use the phrase like emergent gameplay, in that the story is not spoon-fed to you. You really have to go out and discover it. And that's another piece of like exploring the map and learning all the nooks and crannies. It's actually a genuine sort of exploration, which a lot of games have gone away from recently, where it's a very linear, caged-in experience. You know, I like those games a lot too. Like if I can get a really tightly written linear story, I'll buy that 100%, and a couple of my other games are that. But it's fun when you can get a new game these days that's not afraid to really challenge you to figure it out.
Yeah, I like that idea of storing, that you actually unpack it through the design of the levels and seek it out. Is it like a linear sort of games, or is it more sort of open world where you can undertake any mission you want?
Well, it's fairly open world in that you can choose your pathways, but it's not like an expansive, massive map like you would get out of a Skyrim or a Fallout. Right. But you don't really get quests, so that's the interesting part. Like, there's no real direction to it. You know, the direction is kind of seeded into the gameplay in that there are certain checkpoints you can get to and there are some paths that you can take, but there's all kinds of different avenues you can take to get to the end result.
Okay.
And you can experience it in as many as you want, both in terms of the, you know, the map, but also the build and the weapons and the equipment you choose to get there.
I haven't played any of these games, but the biggest appeal is just hearing how difficult it is and how like satisfying it can be to like finally triumph over things
right.
like that. Is there one entry in the series that you'd recommend for people?
Well, I personally think Dark Souls is the most impressive game. I think it really, you know, it synthesizes all those elements so well. I think it does the best job creating this map that's cohesive and that you really can figure out and explore in a really interesting way. But if it was your first time into the series, I do think Dark Souls 3 is probably the most
smooth experience.
Yeah, smooth experience. It's not as disjointed or confusing. It would be easy to get into it, and you know, it's a modern game, so it's very fluid and reasonable. Whereas these other games, you know, I think the combat is excellent, but they can be a bit off-putting to someone who might not be used to that kind of experience.
Katie, would you like to tell us about your game next?
Sure. So as I mentioned earlier, if it was up to me, I guess I would put BioWare games for my five full Monty, but I instead boiled it down to my favorite BioWare game, which is Dragon Age 2, coming to surprise nobody. And if you really want to hear me talk about Dragon Age 2 for several hours, go over to VOK93. So DA2, it was the notorious follow-up to the much-beloved and completely overrated Dragon Age Origins.
Getting started early.
Shots fired. It suffered from a rushed development cycle and was met with lukewarm reception upon its release by both fans and critics, most notably because of its repetitive maps and smaller, less epic story. However, since that has become a bit of a cult classic and is more warmly regarded in the fandom, especially since the release of Inquisition. Unlike Origins and Inquisition, the story doesn't really have that much of an overarching plot. It instead has a unique framing device of being a story within a story. The main story being told by Hawk's friend / unofficial biographer, Varric Tathros, who is being interrogated by the in-universe version of the Catholic Church. So instead of a world-saving scope kind of story, it's instead a much smaller, intimate tale of Hawk's relationships with his family and friends across the span of 7 years as he lives in the city of Kirkwall and the Mage Templar conflict, which is always simmering in the background. I loved it. I've played it more times than I am willing to admit, and it's definitely my security blanket game of when I've had a bad week or when I'm feeling down, I can always boot it up and it makes me feel good. So it is definitely, despite its reputation, I think as being probably the weakest BioWare game, it's the one that I like the most and the one that I come back to the most. And I think old Patrick from, what do we call him now?
Whoa. what do you mean?
Well, that'd make you young. Patrick.
Original Patrick.
There can only be one.
Patrick Classic. I think he said that, you know, if Origins is like Lord of the Rings, then DA2 is more like a sitcom. It's more like Cheers. And I think that's what I find very comforting and kind of unusual about it in that they didn't go for the large scale story of the other two games. It was very much just trying something different and something that was much more familiar and based on friendships, which I don't know, I just love it to death.
The theme of Dragon Age is it depends so much on your connection with the characters. And I think Dragon Age Inquisition is probably the best, most polished game of the series so far. But I can totally see why people would say 2 or the original is the best. Like, I think the original is the best, but whatever.
Yeah, I think the original is the best just because I can romance Morrigan. And
see, yeah, I mean, if you like the characters in a given game, that is true. Like, the characters of a given game may appeal to you personally than someone else.
Yeah, I just like Morrigan, and I like, you can play it in a specific way so you actually don't break up with her, which is good. So you stay with her and go through the mirror and you're not broken up with her, and that's my favorite.
The witch hunt or whatever.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, Origins, I think, is definitely, of the three, is the best just from an RPG standpoint, whereas the other two, they definitely, it seems like the mission statement of the company has gone the way of most, you know, AAA RPGs, which is much more cinematic, and that means much more limited options for role-playing, which is a shame, but, you know, I don't think that's very specific to BioWare. I think that's just the way that most role-playing games have gone, but Origins kind of precedes all that, so it was much more liberal with what it let you do.
Yeah, I think Origins is my favorite as well, for a lot of the same reasons as I gravitated to Dark Souls, in that a lot of the satisfaction in that game is kind of figuring out how to be a better, you know, gameplay player, where you kind of get your build and figure out your build, and it can be really satisfying to take down big enemies on the high difficulties in that game. Like, I find Dragon Age Origins really genuinely challenging. And I'm not at that point where I can just, like, stomp it on Nightmare. Like, I know probably Bing is. So, yeah, you know, I really get a lot out of that. But at the same time, like, I totally agree. I think that Dragon Age 2, like, I always liked it more than a lot of people that I know who were much more down on it after Origins. But it's grown on me more and more. And I think that it does deliver that really, again, that really tight linear story that's got a lot more interesting things going on than maybe the Origins story ever had to offer.
I think I will say this for Dragon Age 2. It is, and I agree with Katie on the point that it is trying something different. Because right now, these games are all going the way of Skyrim, Fallout 4, which is just too much open world, too much sandbox. And I do think they were trying something very different with 2, and just keeping it within a city and focusing on developing a relationship like that. Whether you enjoy that or not, that depends on your own personal taste.
Bing, I just want to counter on that one. There's no such thing as too much open world.
No, I mean, I feel like open world is great, but I feel like not every game has to be like that, right?
No, but the two games that are doing the best, like, you just...
Well, I don't think that's true for everyone. Like, I don't actually love open world that much. I'm not a huge Bethesda guy. I don't really love Fallout or Skyrim or any of the Elder Scrolls games, really. And, like, even Dragon Age Inquisition, I think, you know, I loved it. I'm good at getting lost in that game because I love Dragon Age, but it has its knocks for that reason, in that it feels at times like that big, empty world that doesn't have a lot going on. Whereas you do have to credit Dragon Age 2. For the most part, it really does have a, you know, really packed world full of things to explore. And in the smaller space, admittedly, that it does offer.
Maybe, yeah.
All right. I need to check these games out. Does it matter if you play them out of order? Or should I start with them?
Not really.
No. I've played all the BioWare games out of order, so it doesn't really affect anything.
Okay. Well, I would say yes.
Well, Mass Effect, I'd say it would, but not for Dragon Age.
Mass Effect does have more of a through line, but even then, like, you could experience... Like, I don't think I played Mass Effect 1 the first time I played Mass Effect 2, and it's still a fantastic game. Like,
same, I just went
they really try to catch you up.
Yeah, I just started with 2, and I really enjoyed it.
I'm just sorry, Duncan, I just don't think you would enjoy playing 1 after you've played 2 and 3, because the gameplay is so different and slower than the 2 later versions.
I think some people, like, I went back to 1 after I played 2, and I actually loved it way more than when I tried to play it the first time. But part of that could have been because when I played Mass Effect 1 first time, I was on a console, and I sucked with the Mako. I kept messing up on Novaria. But that's enough of that. We're not on Mass Effect, so I will stop.
Well, you do know the Mako is coming back, right, Zach?
I know, but I'll play it on PC where it belongs, so I can control it just fine.
Bing, would you like to tell us about your first game?
Okay. So there's one company whose games I always play, and that's Paradox Interactive, their company in Sweden, and they make these insane grand strategy games. And the game I picked for this is Europa Universalis IV. The game in which I think more people would play from them is Crusader Kings, especially people from this forum. But Europa Universalis is a little different than that. It's basically you start in the year, 1443, and you can basically play every single country that exists during that time. You can role play as any one of those countries. Like, you want to play as England, you can play as England. You want to play as this tiny little German state, I don't know, Lübeck or whatever, you can play as Lübeck. And you can play as Ming China. And then the game goes on from 1443 to 1821. And there's no way to specifically win or lose. You set your own goals on what you want to do. And that could be world conquest. Although I think pretty much the game makers made world conquest impossible now. Or they could just be survive as Frankfurt so that Austria or France doesn't kill you, or Prussia. So, yeah, the great thing about this game is that literally every single gameplay is going to be different. You start as a different country, it's going to be a completely different game in how you play it. The problem with these games is that they're incredibly hard to get into, since there's so many numbers, tiny little things to get involved. It's high barrier of entry, but once you get into it, it's insane. Just looking at it, I have sunk 794 hours
Whoa.
Into this game.
That's
how it goes.
But the thing is, I played this game for so this much, and I still don't think I'm good at it.
That's not encouraging.
But that's part of the why it's so great and why it could also completely drive people away from it. But yeah.
And this isn't like real time gameplay. This is more like managing numbers and managing economies and things.
Well, no, I mean the time moves, but you can stop the time. A lot of it is basically it's basically a giant board game.
But it's not like Age of Empires where you're moving troops across the battlefield and attacking.
Yeah, you don't specifically control right. An individual soldier or something like that, but yeah.
It's super good.
But I think you send like armies to different areas,
right.
Though, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I recently picked up Crusader Kings 2 when it was on sale, and I spent a few hours trying to figure it out and did very not hard. Do well.
It usually takes you a long time to figure out a Paradox game. The key is to just kind of go at it or look up different strategies.
Expect the first 100 hours to just be failing.
Once you get past the first 100 hours, it gets good.
Yeah, no. Well, but, yeah.
And, okay, good. So quickly, like, you know, after 100 years or so, basically just being defunct is kind of average for our first few tries.
Yes.
Is it mostly, like, logistics-based, or is there actual, like, characters and relationships and plots and things like that?
For EU4, it's just almost completely just strategy. Crusader Kings, you get the role-playing element to it, because you're playing as a dynasty there, so you can play as, I don't know, William the Conqueror.
I think that's a song about Sky mods where you can even get into Essos, like ET and all that, ET dynasties.
We
covered that on the last game roundtable.
That's right. Yeah.
This series is the Paradox games are like my new Dark Souls, in that I'm so afraid to get into it, but after having that video game roundtable and also hearing the History of Westeros people actually pimp out that Game of Thrones mod at Balticon this past year, I really want to get into it, but I'm still so scared because, yeah, it seems so daunting.
It is. Yeah, I think one good way to try and play is try to use the achievement system that the game has, because usually achievements, whatever, right? But for EU4, they have very specific achievements for almost each country that you can play. So so that could serve as sort of a goal. And some of those achievements are going to be pretty simple. Like if you're playing Portugal, it asks you to say found a colony in various continents, and you're Portugal. So of course you're all about exploration. So that could be a way to sort of help you learn the mechanics of the game.
And this is probably a dumb question. What happens in 1821 that the game ends? Is that...
It ends.
The Napoleonic Wars, or anyway.
I mean, supposedly it stops them because it. So the Paradox series basically goes from Crusader Kings, which starts from the medieval era, to the end, to around 1400s, and then EU4 then picks it up, and then gets to 1800, and then they have a next game in the series called Victoria, which starts from there.
Ah, so more.
And it goes and then after that, after that, yeah, Hearts of Iron.
Hearts of Iron, the World War II. So yeah, and it is possible. I think there are mod people have made mods to play all the way from Crusader Kings to Hearts of Iron.
And then is Stellaris in the same sort of space,
no,
or is that a completely
Stellaris okay. is a different?
Oh,
completely different
let's not
game.
Go right. there. Ooh.
Okay, all right. So that's the space one, the space paradox game.
Yes,
right.
But that one's a bit new and not quite as.
Not quite that. right.
Another problem with the paradox game is that there's tons of DLC, tons of paid DLC, and that's how they make their money. Some of them, those DLCs are very good. Some of those DLC are like different colors, troops or something, but that's unfortunately what you have to deal with. That's how they make their money.
I never pay full price for the Paradox games. I'm sorry to say, I usually just pay get a Humble Bundle or something like that, and get all of the extras and stuff like that with it. Like in
That's the way to go.
All right. Well, Patrick, would you like to tell us about your first game?
Yeah. So my first game is gonna be a bit of a not a very popular choice usually. X-Files the game.
Whoa.
Yeah.
That exists?
Yeah. It exists. Or it did a lot of these, and you can still find it on the internet if you want to play it. It was made for PlayStation and Windows and Mac OS in 1998. And it's a point-and-click adventure game, if you know what that is. It's essentially, you have like a character that moves around in an environment, and then you move your cursor or whatever you have over the environment and find interesting stuff to click on that will move you along some sort of story. This specific game is centered around the X-Files series with Scully and Mulder and all those people. While this specific game is not centered completely around them, they appear for a considerable part of the game. It's actually starts out with some FBI agent, Craig Wilmore, it's called, that he needs to find Scully and Mulder because they disappeared. So kind of have to solve this mystery. But it's also, and this is the thing I love a lot about it, this is the first horror type game I've ever played, and I was so scared when I played it. It was either like there's a lot of jump scares and a lot of things where you know, in the X-Files style mystery things that kind of just gives you a lot of suspense. And one of the good things, one of the small funny things you can think about is that in his investigation, he uses like tech devices and stuff like that. And the most advanced thing he has on him is a PDA, which is actually an Apple Newton that he uses, which is kind of fun that anyone would use that. So yeah.
Did they score David Duchovny for the voice?
Oh, he's in. Both of them are in and as voiced characters. It's actually a mix between. It's not animated per se. They actually film all these.
Right.
I remember.
This
old point. Like adventure style, where you like literally put the human people into the game. I remember
those. Yeah, those old like noir, you know, detective stories and a lot of stuff like that.
They did the original Resident Evil as well. They like actually filmed scenes with really bad actors for the cutscenes.
I mean, it's a bit clunky as old time point and click adventure games are, but if you get into it, I get immersed every time.
And you feel it has a cool, like, scary, conspiratorial vibe like the show that it works?
Yeah, exactly. It has it. And for me, I'm not really that. I don't really get scared from, like, thrillers or psychological thrills or whatever like that. But when I'm interacting with the story and the stuff, like, the story elements depend on my performance in the game, I suddenly get immersed completely into a game. So this was the first time I really got those jump scares and whatever, like, made a really big impact on me.
Has anyone else played this game?
No.
Oh.
I'm curious, though. So did this make you a fan of horror games in general, or is this just the one that sticks out as a really good experience? Or do you, like, play all those games?
I don't play all of the horror games, but I do dabble sometimes. When I found like the last horror game I've played other than X-Files is Among the Sleep, where you were you play as a baby trying to escape the, some sort of boogeyman, and it's like small puzzles as well and stuff. And it's the funny thing about it has the mechanic that you feel like you're less capable than a normal human would be. So you have like this impairment, like just like a lot of the other good horror games have like a mechanic where you maybe are forced to, you can only see stuff through a flashlight or something.
Like Outlast.
Yeah, exactly. That
or Amnesia, where like you have the sanity meter and it doesn't give you weapons. I think that's the big thing with the most successful horror games is you're not loaded with weapons, right? Where you can just gun down all the zombies or whatever. Yeah.
When they limit your agency, that's the best kind of games you can actually find when you go into the horror genre.
It's not a point and click, but has anyone played that the demo for the failed Silent Hills, the new Silent Hills game? PT.
I watched it on YouTube.
I watched it. I do not have the balls to play that game.
Yeah, it's similar, sort of confining you to a certain set of paths in a way that's similar to sort of a point and click where you're sort of investigating and finding clues to advance. But it's super scary, super psychologically unnerving.
The thing I love about that in particular in horror games like that is when it introduces new elements to the same environment where like things are just appearing and happening. I love that as a horror mechanic. It's like things are just randomly popping up that add to the scare factor.
And the sense that you can't escape, like you just have to look further and further into the thing that you're frightened of, because that's the only way out.
Yep.
My first pick for a favorite video game is Dishonored. It's a stealth action game made by Arkane Studios and published by Bethesda.
Bethesda.
Yeah, sorry. And it's basically you are the former royal protector for an empress who has been murdered and you have been framed for it. And your mission is basically to get her daughter back and place her on the throne in her rightful place. And it's set in the capital of the empire, which is called Dunwall. And it's a very steampunk sort of electrode Victorian London setting where you basically, everything is overrun with a plague as well, so that's fun, but you have like different choices on how you want to play. You can either go full stealth mode, knock guys out, hide their unconscious bodies. Similarly, you could still play stealth but kill them instead of just knocking them unconscious, but that will attract rats and such. Or you can go full crazy person and use these magic powers you obtain to send swarms of rats to devour your enemies. And just basically, you have all these different ways of killing people in horrendous methods. So that's one of my favorites, mostly just because of the story. Throughout the story, you get this whole look that there's a much bigger world outside the city of Dunwall. And then it also has a DLC, The Knife of Dunwall and The Witches of Brigmore. And they add a lot to just the world in general. And also because I had to bring it up because Dishonored 2 is going to be coming out soon. And that's another thing I am really looking forward to.
Yeah, you can play as Emily in that one too. The girl who's the empress.
Yeah. I can't wait to play.
I think the greatest thing about Dishonored is actually its art style. It's just this. It's beautiful, but something a little bit off about everything as well.
Yeah, and just like the design of everything, from just the way the city looks compared to just kind of the people who live there. You have like the gang leaders of Slackjaw. You have the crazy old woman who is Granny Rags. You have the mad scientists Piero and Sokolov, and it's just it really, you can really immerse yourself in that game, which I've just enjoyed. And the fact that because you're a silent protagonist, you can kind of imprint yourself on the character of Corvo, so that's something that adds to the game, I think.
This is one of those games that's been very high on my personal wall of shame for a very long time. And hopefully it'll be the sequel that eventually gets people to play it. I played the first hour of it a couple of years ago, but it didn't end up grabbing me to the point that I continued. I generally speaking, am not a huge fan of stealth games, but I know in this game, of course, you can play it in a lot of different ways. You can do the non-lethal route, or you can just go through and murder everyone, or whatever in between that you prefer. But it just, for whatever reason, I haven't jumped into it yet. But I've heard good things from a lot of people, and Paul, obviously, you have good things to say about it too. And like the aesthetic of it, from what little I experienced, is amazing. Like that steampunky feel is so cool. Yeah. I don't know why I haven't just committed to it yet.
Yeah, definitely. And it also kind of has that same thing that Dark Souls has, where you can find out more about the world by just looking around. And right. It makes, because you're very confined in this kind of grimy city. But then you'll find a book that talks about, oh, the Southern Isle is rife with pirates and romance and all these other places. And then you'll also find out that the islands themselves are just a real small part of the world, and the rest is just kind of undiscovered.
I will say this for Corvo. Usually you have, when you have unvoiced protagonists, they're unvoiced because you get to insert yourself into them. But what's interesting about Corvo is that he also has this huge background to history. It's also embedded within the story itself. So he's a silent protagonist, but he's very much his own character. So that you can influence what he becomes, especially if you choose to kill a lot of people or avoid killing people. But he has his own history, and his actions doesn't just affect himself, but affect a lot of different people as well. Try not to spoil the game.
For sure.
So is this something they're getting away from in the sequel? Are they going to give him a voice and more of a character, or are they sticking with that idea?
As far as I know, they are actually giving them voices, both Emily and Corvo. So I'm thinking they're going a bit more narrative on it.
Yeah. I mean, I was kind of hoping that it would just be you play as Emily, and I'd be all right with her being voiced because she's an NPC in the game, and you kind of grow attached to her, and then I'd be fine because she already kind of has her voice that you've seen develop in the first game. But I suppose that I don't really have that much of a problem because in the DLC, Knife of Dunwall and Brigmore Witches, you don't play as Corvo, you play as Dowd, an assassin who you actually meet in the original part of the game. And he does talk to you, so I suppose I like the silent protagonist bit, but I'm not, like, dependent on it, really.
And with Corvo and Emily, are they going to have fundamentally different stories in Dishonored 2, or is it just the same story with different characters?
I think they're each going to be, like, doing different things in the story. So, like, while Emily's doing one thing, you can then go to Corvo, who's going to be in his own little story area.
But, oh, so it's like a GTA 5 thing where you, like, switch as you play?
I think so, yeah.
Okay.
Because you can play both characters.
That's cool. And they have different sort of mechanics, I assume, as far as you can play, like, the combat.
Yeah, it looks like Corvo still retains kind of the magic powers he has in the first game, while Emily has, like, a bunch of the new ones that they've brought out. So depending on what your play style is, if you want to go tried and true, you would probably favor Corvo's storyline, but if you want to try something new, Emily's the way to go, I suppose.
All right. Adam, would you like to tell us about your first game?
Yeah, so I kind of went with not more recent stuff and more stuff that, I don't know, was, I think, kind of formative to my gaming growing up. So I guess my first pick would have to be Metal Gear Solid, because that came out in 1998, course, it's a Kojima game, and it's the whole reason I bought a PlayStation. I was 14, I had my first job, and I, like, had to have this game. And I remember, like, going with my father and him being like, well, that's mature rated, you can't buy that game. And so I had to, like, go back later. I just, like, bought the console, he's like, with no games. I'm like, oh, I'll just rent stuff. And I just went back later and bought it myself. And so I have a certain, like, nostalgic connection to it, but also it was just, you know, it was very different from everything at the time, you know, just the, like, 3D stealth, the storyline's a lot of fun and silly, over the top, and it's just, it's one of those things that a lot of other games call back to over the years. So I just, like, yeah, it's just, it's a ridiculous game, but it's a game I remember, like, playing over and over again, you know, in the middle of the night when everybody was asleep.
Metal Gear is one of those things that is so audaciously convoluted and absurd in the story that it's telling that it's like, I feel like I should have contempt for how ludicrous, like what we are expected to swallow in each of these games. But instead I just admire it because Kojima just does not give a shit.
Nope.
It seems like, yeah, I'm the guy that I love when like a movie is like, you know, it's just kind of like bad in that good way, you know, where it's like ridiculous and they just like, they let us go on that ride where we don't have to, things don't have to make sense. You know, we have this giant walking T-Rex, metal T-Rex. Like, what's the point of that? It shoots nukes. It's, you know, tactical. It's okay, I guess. Sure. And then you got a ninja who's a robot. You know, it's just all, everyone's just real, real creepy. And then like little things like, you know, you back then the, you know, the internet, it, like all this stuff wasn't really at your fingertips. And so you'd read it in magazines or you'd hear from friends. And like one of the early boss encounters with like Psycho Mantis, and you know he can read like the save file on your memory card, and he could make your, you know, make your controller move and all this weird stuff. And you'd be like, oh, if you just plug it into controller port 2, he can't do anything, you know, like just like little things like that, you know, which is ridiculous and a lot of fun.
Yeah, I remember.
Nano machines.
The first time I saw it was my cousin was playing and just being amazed at, like, even just the intro where you get the credits and he's stealthing around and avoiding security cameras. Like, it was such a cool gameplay idea.
Yeah.
I didn't have a PlayStation. I only had the N64. So it was like GoldenEye versus Metal Gear Solid. That was the rivalry back then.
Yeah, and I had both. I was always a Nintendo growing up. We had Nintendo. It was like, you know, screw Sega. And then this was like, well, I have to get something different because this is only on PlayStation. And... you know, I think I've had every PlayStation ever since.
Do you remember the first PlayStation commercial?
I mean, probably, what was it?
Console opened up and like Michael Jordan and a bunch of other like game characters were in these like leveled rings around the console, and I was like, I don't know, 12 maybe when it came out, and I thought, oh my god, that's so cool. And I thought that's how it would be.
You thought like the future was now.
We have crossed the threshold.
Yeah, but it's like, remember when the PlayStation 2 came out and they had that commercial? It was like for the PlayStation 9, and it was like, you know, spores delivered directly into your brain. You know, and you're like, oh, and like it's got nothing to do with what they're selling you. It's just a cool commercial.
Did anyone see the teaser for Kojima's next project?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
Norman Reedus gives birth on a beach.
Wow.
No. What is up with him and Norman Reedus?
Like, it's something.
Why wouldn't he look like Norman Reedus?
What is up with him and anything?
Yeah, Kojima is like the David Lynch of video games.
I remember the trailer for Revengeance where they used the PS3, what was it called? The remote? And it just had a shot of him, of the character just like slicing up a body like salami. It was so gross. It was like the Wiimote version of the PS3. I can't remember what it was called.
Oh, where you could like chop people up like watermelons.
Yeah.
Oh,
and like you could see he was praising the angles, like all the detailed angles you could slice someone up. It was pretty good.
I would rather say that Kojima is the Pablo Picasso of video gaming.
Fair enough.
He has his periods. He gets one stick he wants to really just signal out to the world that he's very passionate about, and then he goes on to another project. Like right now, it seems like he's more about environmentalism and stuff like that in the Death Stranding video.
But I like he can try to pump in these like serious messages like nuclear war and, you know, global warming and things, and then it's like, you know, there's just like a soldier that's like pooping his pants, and there's, you know, just like like really ridiculous stuff.
A monkey smoking a cigarette and drinking whiskey. Yeah. he is an auteur, and I think he's one of the few people that you can really say in video games that is like a purely auteur. He does what he wants, and it usually, I mean, sometimes it's insane what he does, but it usually works. Like, it gets a reaction. It's fun or it's weird.
All right. Hannah, are you here?
I am.
Would you like to tell us about your first pick?
Yeah, so first pick is Tomb Raider, the original one. It features Lara Croft, who's an awesome badass at everything, and she can do side flips and tumbling. I basically picked mine on how many hours I spent playing them and how much enjoyment I got out of them. And Tomb Raider's awesome. It's a mixture between shoot 'em up type stuff and puzzle solving. And Lara is like an adventure, like an Indiana Jones type character. I think most people are familiar with the premise.
Yeah.
And then you get to fight Satan at the end.
Perfect.
Is that how the first Tomb Raider ends? Are you kidding?
Not Satan. It's like an Incan demon or something, or like Egyptian demon. Like, I think it's supposed to be like Osiris, like you raid his tomb and then he comes to life and you're on this like square platform above lava, and the only way to beat it is with the shotgun and by tumbling the entire time. And then when he lets out his little blast of whatever, you have to like roll off the platform and hang and then climb back up and shoot him in the face.
Is Tomb Raider 1 the one where you have that tutorial level at the beginning where you're in her mansion and you can lock the butler in the freezer?
Yes, ma'am. And I just spent many hours in there just effing around. It's awesome.
That was one of the cool things about
the second one.
Sorry.
In that level, you get to go in her pool and swim, like outside. You get to go outside. It's fun.
Played a little bit of the game as a kid. I remember fighting a tiger and fighting some dogs and just finding it impossible to shoot the dogs, but it was fun.
Yeah. One thing about it is like the music in it's really, really creepy. Oh, yeah. And so I used to play it on mute in the middle of the night while listening to Howard Stern so that I wouldn't get scared.
Double creepy.
That was kind of the cool thing about those games that were not necessarily open world is not the word I'm looking for, but like the story was so simple and the worlds were so bare that you could kind of invent your own story as you were going along, or at least that's what I did with stuff like Tomb Raider and Zelda. Is like I spent hours running around her mansion too, even though there's really not anything to do there, but it just felt like you could kind of tell her story in your head while you were playing, or at least that's what I did when I was a kid.
And being like the first 3D spaces that you could run around in, did feel the sense of just infinite possibilities that you could fill in. It was such a big jump from 2D.
Yeah, very enjoyable. Many hours spent. And then, you know, collecting everything. I don't know. I like them because they are a little simple and you can take them more or less at your own pace.
And have you played the newer
It's an old.
Oh, Christ. Don't even get me started.
You don't like the new ones? Yeah.
Lara Croft, not a Tomb Raider, is how I like to call it. Yeah, I mean, the graphics were great and the action was better, but that's not why I like to play those games. I liked them because of the puzzles of having to solve actually how to get into the tomb and get the thing you need to beat the level. And the only tomb raiding you do in that is you go through a sequence of some nonsense and you're totally guided through it. Like the thing pops up on the Xbox, it tells you which button to press. And then all it is opening a box and boom, you have it. And there was no real skill involved in it to me or thought process. And I just,
But like the context clues and kind of guiding people through stuff like that, that's kind of pervasive now.
Yeah, I love the Uncharted games, but it is a more linear sort of, it funnels you along a particular path more. There's a lot more cutscenes, there's a lot more real-time button things, a lot more sort of shooting. There isn't that sort of exploratory element that you would get with these.
There's definitely more shooting. I would say in the most recent Tomb Raider, you know, the sequel to the reboot, I think it does a pretty good job giving you that kind of open world experience in the vein of I think the best example would be like one of the Batman games or like Shadow of Mordor, which came out a couple of years ago, where you have this like big map you can explore and get collectibles and things. But if that's it's a different experience. It's like a theme park experience.
Put off by the first new Tomb Raider that I haven't tried the second, even though I've heard it's better, but I'm just kind of not interested anymore.
There can be more of a feeling of just sort of going through the motions, hitting the beats that the game wants you to hit, so it is less of a sense of freedom, even though it is sort of fun in the moment playing out these huge set pieces, but maybe, you know, 10 years from now it won't seem as fun.
It was more story-driven, too, than, like, the first ones. It's all very much about her, and I thought that was kind of cool, but it's... I don't know. I think I turned to my husband at some point when I was playing it and said, you know, if they wanted to make a Tomb Raider movie, why didn't they just make a fucking Tomb Raider movie?
Well, they did.
They did. Three of them.
It was terrible.
I do not acknowledge those.
might move on. So my first game is an adventure game by Rareware. It was released in 1995 for the Super Nintendo, and it is called Donkey Kong Country 2. The game is a 2D side-scroller,
yes,
where players take control of simian buddies Diddy and Dixie Kong as they traverse pirate ships, swamps, beehives, volcanoes, mines, and castles to rescue Donkey Kong from the evil King K. Rool. The game plays a mix of jumping between platforms, swinging between vines, launching between barrel cannons, or while evading or killing a wide variety of enemies. There's also minecart levels, underwater levels, a wealth of timed bonus levels, which are hidden throughout the game. So what I love about the game is how stressful and adrenaline pumping it can be at times. It's a very tough game, and often one hit will be enough to lose a life and make you restart the level. A lot of the action depends upon timing out jumps perfectly, reacting quickly to threats and opportunities. It can be incredibly frustrating, a lot like Zach was saying with Dark Souls, but it never really feels cheap, so whenever you fail, you sort of know why you failed, and gradually you sort of get better and better until you can beat the level, and it feels very satisfying. The other really striking thing about Donkey Kong Country 2, as well as some of the other games in the series, is how gorgeous it looks and sounds, like even today. So the gameplay is 2D, it's a side-scroller, but the graphics are made up of detailed, pre-rendered 3D sprites, which was sort of a big deal at the time. And this gives the environments a very vibrant, polished feel, injects the characters with sort of this playful energy. And combined with this is the soundtrack, which is a mix of really sort of atmospheric music, natural environmental sounds and ambience. For me, the presentation and the gameplay works really well together, and it creates this great rhythm. So when you're playing it, it can be both exciting and sort of really relaxing at the same time. Any thoughts on Donkey Kong Country 2? Anyone else played it?
I have. Is it two or three, the one, there's a level in there where to ride on Dixie Kong as the spider, and like the whole thing is lava and you have to shoot webs to through the entire level.
Yeah, that's another gameplay.
It's so hard.
You have these like animal buddies that can you traverse in different ways. You can get on the spider and that can move vertically over obstacles with the webs, but the webs are like temporary, so they disappear after a few seconds. There's also Squawks the bird, so she can navigate through sky thorn bushes and things like that. Rambi the rhino, you can use to bust up enemies, burst through walls.
The minecart levels were always my favorite of any Donkey Kong game.
The water levels are really tricky in this one too.
Yeah, the water worlds are so like relaxing to play. Just the music is really nice.
Yeah,
just floating around.
They can be really frustrating though.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, it is. Yeah, it can be just like it's very unforgiving. You get hit once, you miss a platform by a few sprites, you fall to your death, have to restart again and again. You only get like 5 lives per go, so you can get game over pretty quickly.
You haven't played the Donkey Kong Wii, have you, Duncan?
I've played the one on the Wii, Donkey Kong Country Returns. I haven't played the Wii U one, Tropical or something. But, I do want to play it if I ever get a Wii.
Tropical Freeze.
Tropical Freeze.
I've heard good things about the Wii U one. I haven't played it either. It felt like my whole experience with these kind of games was I came a little bit too late for like the SNES and the Super Nintendo versions, and I ended up picking them up on the Game Boy Color and like the re-releases for this and for Mario as well, for the original Super Mario Bros. And you know, I loved all those games. I think Mario I kind of lean more towards, but I really, really loved the Donkey Kong Country 2, 3, loved them all.
Yeah, I love Mario 2. Mario is it's a bit different. The camera is much further back. I feel like Donkey Kong is more momentum based. You're in the air a lot more. There's a lot of times the ground isn't safe to be on, so you sort of have to jumping from one enemy to the next, sort of creating sequences in those games.
Yeah. I think I fell more into Sonic also than I ended up getting into the Donkey Kong Country. I think also just by virtue of the fact that there were more games, to play.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, any more to say, or should we move on to round two? Zach, would you like to tell us about your second game?
Sure. So I'm going to go back to the BioWare bin pick out my next game. And for me, this is the game that started it all. Knights of the Old Republic.
Yes.
That is my pick. This was my first BioWare game. It was the one that got me into all their games, and kind of I credit it for opening the door to things like Dragon Age and Mass Effect, which I also am very fond of. You know, they're really high up there on the favorite video game list. It is the seminal RPG for Star Wars, in that I don't think many would give anything that is a fair comparison. Some people might say the Star Wars Jedi Academy or Jedi Outcast, those sort of games are pretty good too, but I think that this one really stands out both as a quality RPG
that's really fun to play, but also has a really excellent story. You know, it's considered one of the highest quality pieces of Star Wars literature, I suppose, outside of the films. You know, this is one of the ones they go back to as things that they hope that are included in this new version of the extended universe we're getting with the Force Awakens and all this new stuff coming out that they've done. And, you know, people really love this story and they hope that it finds its way into that canon somehow. It takes place, I think, 3,000 years before the movies take place. But weirdly, it looks exactly like regular Star Wars because that's how Star Wars works. You play as a character that you give a name to. You can pick a class and you progress through its story and you meet all kinds of different characters. And it's all set in the Star Wars universe. You go to different planets of different biome types, as Star Wars tends to be. You pick, you know, complete biomes. You go to Tatooine is one of them. Kashyyyk, which is the Wookiee planet, is another. And as you progress and you do the missions that you're laid out, you learn more about yourself and also the characters around you. And you have to stop the big bad Dark Jedi fellow. And it's amazing. It's one of my favorite games ever. And I credit it not just for getting me into BioRPGs, but also reigniting my interest in Star Wars, which now is one of my, you know, favorite fandoms ever. I love all of the main stuff and also the EU. But this is the piece of media that really got me into the EU half and also just got me more passionate about the whole thing in general.
Yeah, I agree with everything
Zach just said.
I would say yes on most of it, but there is a few things that I didn't actually like that much about the first Knights of the Old Republic.
Right.
For example, the whole first planet you were on takes way too long and it's way too much going up and down of levels. I can't actually remember the name of it, of the planet.
It's Terrace.
Terrace.
Yeah. That planet needs there's been mods actually just to remove that whole part and we get all the rewards for it because a lot of people hate that
because it feels pointless. I get it, but I don't know. I like that first bit. I think like playing through it again, you're kind of like I kind of want to speed through this, but on a first playthrough I think that's all very essential.
Yeah, I think it really, you know, I've heard this complaint a lot, but I think it really succeeds you into getting immersed into the sort of gameplay and story that KOTOR in particular is telling, with things like the dueling arena is just a fun little romp that you can do, which I really enjoy personally. The speeder racing, the going around collecting bounties, just like exploring all these nooks and crannies of this place, I personally found really gratifying, and it really did succeed in getting into
it.
You're right.
You can speed through a lot of that. You can like just get past a lot of that if you don't want to do it.
Yeah, you have the option to skip. And it's true, like, the game picks up dramatically after that. But, you know, that's kind of a fun thing that I think is true of a lot of good games. You know, like Final Fantasy VII, one of the, you know, the greatest RPGs of all time by many people's estimation, has the same sort of thing where it really opens up. And I think that is kind of a good quality of an RPG.
Yeah.
I would say that one thing, like, not like to, I mean, the game's so old, but not to, like, give any spoilers or anything. But, I mean, you're, like, kind of the standard, you know, you pick... And you're just a guy, and you know you maybe become a Jedi, whatever, right? But like I think that a lot of like skills and things come very quickly in that game, and they also want you to feel a little bit like you're earning it a bit, like not like it's all just handed to you. Although I mean, there's reasons for all that, you know, that you find out later on. But I think that first planet kind of puts you through your paces a little bit as a character, and you feel like, oh well, yeah, my character has this skill now, or okay, maybe, you know, yeah, maybe he's able to do this or that, and it kind of makes a bit of sense.
You also get the wonderful character that is HK-47.
Yes, one of the best characters. So smarmy. He's a droid that has no patience for the meatbags, he says.
And more like asymmetric ships and weird things. And I feel like in the Star Wars universe, the only excuse must be that like ship design is like is highly, I don't know, like reverential, you know? They're like, well, we've been building houses this way for thousands of years. So, you know.
You have your own Millennium Falcon, essentially, that you fly around in. That's your hub area to hang out with all your party members. And it's basically the same exact ship as the Millennium Falcon, of course.
It's just red and a little bit different in design, a little more blocky.
Well, it's like it's like poetry. Everything rhymes.
Exactly. You know, there's a great ring that it all surrounds.
Everything rhymes for thousands of years.
Again and again.
No improvement in lightsaber technology.
There's another thing I didn't like about the series was at the end, no spoilers, but or maybe a little spoilers, all of the characters you can befriend, just like in any other Dragon Age or Mass Effect, you have a lot of characters that you befriend and improve your standing with. But in this specific game, it feels very heavy-handed when you finally have improved all the characters standing with you to the maximum and then progress to the final act of the story. Because then they all seem like, oh, and I actually like you very much because of this reason that was very convoluted. And the other one, oh, yeah, you're so good. I'm going to follow you to the end because of what – oh, that reason just –
Remember that one time at hour 23?
Because I'm a role player, you know. I do role playing, like pen and paper and whatever. And usually our choices as characters in the story has to make sense. And if I had done something like that as a GM to made every single NPC suddenly pledge their allegiance in one way or another because of obscure and convoluted reasons, my players would just look at me like, what are you doing? What is this? Come on, you can do better.
It's that scene in the movie. Like, I mean, I don't know.
Yeah, I'd agree. I mean, I think if you had situated, it's more of like, you know, it's like a beginner's RPG almost. It kind of introduces you to these mechanics, and then you go to something else to see the more advanced, more nuanced perspective.
Cool. Shall we move on? Who's next?
Sure. My second choice is Red Dead Redemption Rockstar in 2010. Yep. It's a open world third person action adventure game. It follows the story of John Marston, a former outlaw whose family is being held captive by the federal marshals. And their release is promised under the condition that Marston hunt down his former gang members. His hunt takes him across the American West into Mexico and beyond. And it's also very much a Rockstar game in that there is a ton of side content to explore and play. I think it was Greg said that he used to load up the game just to spend hours playing blackjack, which you can definitely do. There's a limited morality system that you can gain honor and lose honor for good deeds or doing bad deeds. I was a fan of tying people up and putting them on railroad tracks, so my honor was pretty shit in the game. It's weird because I played GTA 3, I played GTA 4, and I never finished either of those games. I feel like Rockstar, they're incredibly good at telling well-written, extremely detailed stories, but their stories are very, very, very long. Go on, I think they end up repeating themselves a little too much. And Red Dead is the one story where, yeah, the Mexico bit is a little, it outstates its welcome a little, but I enjoyed almost every minute of it. And the ending is my favorite video game ending ever. It knocked the wind out of me the first time I played it, and really no other game ending has really affected me as much as Red Dead's ending. The use of music in the game is also really spectacular, and I think a lot of people remember riding into Mexico while I forget the name of the song, but there's a song that plays over while you're going into the second area that's just, it gives me chills every time. It's just very atmospheric and with a consideration to what you're feeling at the time. So yep, I love me some Red Dead.
Yeah, I love that game. I love just like riding through the vast environment. It looks so nice. The sun's setting over you. And yeah, that first time you ride into Mexico and you get the strumming and the chills down your spine. It's some really cool, just beautiful visuals.
I definitely have a slight bias because any game that lets me ride a horse, I love horses. So if you give me a horse and say, go ride around this vast empty area, this is actually going to come up at another point on my list, but I'm pretty much in the pocket at that point. There's been rumors of a sequel for a long time, which is a terrible idea because I don't understand how there can be a sequel to Red Dead Redemption, and I hope it never comes about, but who knows.
It was the sequel, right?
It was to the Red Dead Revolver was the original game, but as I understand it, they have nothing to do with each other.
Well, not nothing, but yeah, it's not. Yeah. And I still play like Undead Nightmare whenever whenever Halloween's coming up, so I'll put a few hours into that.
Yep, excellent DLC. It's a very sad side mission involving Bigfoot in that game.
Oh, yeah.
Poor Bigfoot.
think it's weird because, like, most people love GTA, and most people just know GTA. But I feel like games like that, or, I don't know, what's the other, the one that's setting Hong Kong. It's not by Rockstar, but, like, Sleeping Dog?
Sleeping Dogs, yeah.
These games, I feel like, are much more, I don't know, relatable. I feel like the characters in GTA are all such shitty human beings. Yeah. And I can't even connect with them at any level. Whereas in Red Dead and in Sleeping Dogs, you feel like these are troubled people, but which have the potential of doing really bad things, but you understand them more as humans.
Yeah, I agree. I only got about halfway through GTA 4 as well. It's like fun to ride around and cause havoc for a little bit, but after that you get into the story and it's not really compelling. You don't really like the characters that much.
Yeah.
But Red Dead Redemption is so involved. And
You keep wanting to go back to that core story, right?
Yeah, there's just a fundamental pleasure about exploring and getting into new adventures. And
my understanding, I honest to God, I haven't played either of these games, but I know a lot about them in an abstract sense. My understanding is that at least in GTA 5, they seem to take a lot of the lessons they learned from Red Dead Redemption and apply them to that story. And it may still be true that their characters are reprehensible and the main gist of the game is to mess stuff up, but it sounds like that game had a pretty interesting story as well.
Yeah, I mean, I want to get to that game, but I have to finish the fourth one at some point or I just won't. But I do feel like part of the aspect is that we're more removed from the world of Red Dead Redemption than we are of the Grand Theft Auto world. Like, someone stealing a car and drugs and hookers and all that is something that actually happens, and maybe you kind of, you know, have a harder time detaching from that. Or, like, my thing with GTA is I would get in there and I'd blow stuff up. I'd do this, you know, and I after half an hour, I'd be like, wait, where was the mission? You know, I'm going to do something else.
Yeah, I could never
you know,
find
but
anything.
With Red Dead Redemption, I never had that problem. So, like, whenever I go on, like, a little side quest, I'd find something interesting. And then, like, okay, no, now I've got to go, you know, I got to go down to Mexico and I got to, you know, I got to get this done before I can stop.
There was a It is very rare nowadays for something to make me want to break my controller. I remember there was an evening when I was playing Red Dead Redemption where the quest was to go pick flowers on this one very specific hill that was swarming with mountain lions. And I have never been more furious. I was livid because, ride your horse up, get off the horse, like, oh God, there's mountain lions around here. Pick the flowers, boom, like a freaking cat assassin come out of nowhere, knock you off your horse dead immediately. It took me an hour to pick the flowers, and by the end of that quest, I was running away. I was like, thank God, and rode right off a cliff and died. And it was like
open season on those cats.
Mountain lions are the fucking worst in that game, and it was the first time in many years where I was just like, I have to put my controller down because otherwise I'm going to throw it against the wall.
Yeah, there's some tough
collectibles. There's a lot of skinning.
Yeah, I remember I got all the horses because you had to find all the different breeds of horses, but I couldn't find those beavers or there's a few other animals I couldn't track down. I just couldn't even find them to kill them.
There is no game, I think, that I would want a PC remaster of more badly than this game. And I don't think I'm the only one. So Rockstar, I know you're making like billions of dollars off GTA 5 DLC, but you're leaving money on the table.
Oh,
please make
PC.
Make this game for PC, please.
Yeah.
I want to play it.
The controls are great as well, like just riding on the horse and shooting feels really good. And shootouts in towns, like you'll get to a town and have to kill a bunch of bandits, is really fun too. It's been a couple of years since I played it, but very fond memories.
The gunplay early on is a little clumsy until they introduce the Deadeye mechanic, which basically it's a target-on system, which makes things a lot more interesting.
Okay.
Yep.
We might move on. Who is next? It is Bing.
Right. So my second game is, what's the genre? City management? It's not really a city, but I guess a construction sim game. It's called Tropico. In which and there's like five games in the series now, but basically the setting is you take over as a dictator of a Caribbean island country, and then the point of the game is basically you have to build up your country, small little island country, into a functional economy, whether through industry or through tourism, and you have to stay in power, whether that is by being such a great leader that everybody wants to vote for you, or you commit election fraud, murder people who are against you, and then rule the island with an iron fist. It's also taking place during the 20th century, during the Cold War period, so you have to deal with the U.S. and USSR trying to influence you in either direction. So you start out, you can choose what kind of leader you want to be. You can customize who you are, or you can choose from a list of people that's basically caricatures of leaders at a time, like Fidel Castro or Agustin Pinochet or, I don't know, what was the choices? Evita Peron. So you play as dictator, and it's a fun game because the game knows what its setting is, and there's tons of tongue-in-cheek poking fun of just the characteristics of a banana republic.
My only connection to this game is it was the game that was pointed to people to go play when SimCity was shitting the bed back when that came out a couple of years ago.
Right. Yes. It's a very different experience. Especially since the original game came out, I don't know, what was it? Came out back in 2001. But it had a very, very crazy sequel that's just about pirates. But it has since then been bought out by another publisher. So it's much more focused on campaign. So not quite the same experience in 4, but definitely if you enjoy like building up a city or in this case a country, then it's a good choice. And it's hilarious.
So what's the replay value? So is it very narratively focused, or are there like branching things that happen and just kind of is like generated in that way?
Well, you can, there's different ways. So there's a sandbox option, and there are different ways to build your economy for your island, and there's different play styles. You can either play like a military dictatorship and just build up your army and crush anybody who stands in your way. Or you can actually try to make everybody happy and give them all the amenities they want, meanwhile trying to keep your country afloat, your economy afloat, and steal some money for your Swiss bank account.
Of course, yeah.
Can there be like a coup?
Yes. Your island citizens can turn to rebels, and they will start fighting you, and you can build up an army to try and fight them back.
Can you just like blow up a whole city to prove a point and stop the rebellion?
Not so much blow up. Well, there's not much city to blow up because there's only a small island. But you can definitely, say, find your family member and put them into prison, which declare them as heretics.
Naturally.
Yeah. Naturally.
Kind of reminds me of the board game Hunt Junta. Yeah, if anyone has tried that, this is essentially also your couple of people playing leaders in a single banana republic. And you start out by electing your il presidente, and and he's then tasked with dealing out like roles and offices and whatever, and then doling out money from the banana harvest. So yeah, essentially, this is a lot of things where you meal and deal and stuff like that. You try to make everyone happy, but you'd never get enough money to make everyone happy. So essentially, you end up trying to make the most powerful people happy and then just put the rest of the money in your Swiss bank account. I love that kind of game. So maybe I would like Tropico as well.
Yeah. If you're interested in playing, the original Tropico is actually still very playable. But I think Tropico 4, the fourth edition in the series, I think that has like the most stuff built up now. That I think 5, the newest one, went into a different direction and tried to institute some sort of timeline to the game, so that even the game moves from like colonial era to Great War era and such and such. And I don't know if that quite works. So I think Tropico 4 is still the best version to play, especially.
Well,
since
I do need an outlet for my tyrannical impulses, so I look into this.
And if you're interested in fighting Richard Nixon, he shows up.
Oh, yeah, I've always wanted to fight Richard Nixon. So.
Nice cameo. Yeah. All right. Patrick, what is your second game?
It's more of a franchise as a whole, but I've chosen one game out of the franchise. To no big surprise for a lot of people, one of my favorite franchises is the Pokemon franchise. I love every single game from the first to the sixth generation. Started out coming out in 1996 in Japan and 1998 in the rest of the world. And my favorite version of it is, well, it's all defined by colors and metals types and whatever. But my favorite ones is the second generation, where the names of the games are Gold, Silver, and Crystal. Personally, Crystal was my first game I started on because I wasn't on the Pokemon train to begin with, but I got completely hooked thereafter. The game itself is a JRPG. It has you playing a silent character, silent protagonist, that moves around the world catching different monsters in this world to use in your team to fight against other trainers who have Pokemon as well. Other than that, you also move through a story where there's usually a criminal society or organization that tries to do something nasty or whatever and maybe take over the world sometimes. And then you stop them as a 11-year-old kid, but that's kind of the charm of it.
Living on your own with monsters.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. And then as the way to gauge your progression is to go to these gyms. There's 8 of these gyms, and each gym you can collect a badge if you defeat the gym leader. And when you've collected all 8 badges, you can go to the Pokemon League. And then if you do that, you usually beat the first main part of the game. But as a grinder, a person that collects stuff, I use a lot of time getting every single Pokemon, sometimes in both genders, if there are genders in that game.
What about the shinies? Have you finished your shiny?
I'm not done with the shiny hunt, but I have started on it.
Gotcha.
But I need, in this generation I'm playing now, I'm playing the last generation 6 with auras and stuff. I'm trying to get a full national dex before, so then I can get an item that makes it easier to get shinies. So
right, yes.
In that sense, I'm still working on it. But
so, Patrick, which Pokemon is your favorite?
Which Pokemon is my favorite?
Seems like a leading question.
What kind of Pokemon are you?
My favorite is Jigglypuff, so I want to know what Patrick's favorite Pokemon is.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's either an Aipom or a Gengar.
What's Gengar? The first one?
Aipom.
It's a monkey.
It's a monkey with a hand that's for a tail. Okay.
Gengar is very cool.
Are they post 150 Pokemon?
Gengar isn't.
Okay.
Aipom is, it's third gen. But yeah, Gengar is one of the ridge.
One of the originals.
Yeah.
Yeah. The series is my childhood in a nutshell, basically. Some of my earliest memories are playing
you
the original Pokemon games. Yeah, I had the whole Pokemon experience. I'm old
At
enough
11,
for that.
At 11, they were like, get out. Here's a buddy that's going to, like,
exactly.
Electrocute you. Hopefully you don't die.
Yeah, I mean, that's what Pokemon Go is, right? Like, I'm living it right now. I totally was in it as well, big time. I was a huge fan. I watched the anime as well for years, and it's definitely one of those up there games for me as being formative and really entertaining.
Like I played the first one, and I was just I was the right age when that came out and everything. And I remember like my brother and I both had Game Boys, but he kind of wasn't really into it. But I got Red and Blue just so I could like get a bunch of have all the starter Pokemon to trade, and then like try to get the other ones I didn't have. And
yeah,
but outside of the like 150, I don't really know much of the other ones. Like my son has kind of like with all the Pokemon craze lately, he's like super into Pokemon all of a sudden, so I'm kind of experiencing a bit more of it. But I didn't play like when Gold and Silver came out, I was like, oh, that looks cool, but I had like way too much other stuff going on. So
hasn't the combat changed significantly? I feel like I caught a glimpse, and I don't know how the show and the games are even still interrelated, but like the show is so bonkers now, it's like nuclear bombs going off every single episode. And in the show, don't they have like paired combat, like you fight alongside other people?
Yeah, and stuff. I mean, it's the same thing. In the games now, it's evolved. You can have like double battles or triple battles or rotation battles, whatever like that. There's a different themes too. You can have different types of games. But a lot of the extra things that like Ash being able to sort of mind meld with Greninja, that doesn't go appear in the
Wait,
in the game.
What's happening now?
What?
Oh yeah, it's essentially Ash and Greninja get so synced that they kind of turn into the same person.
Actually, I remember something like that during the Battle
like
Frontier.
Headmaster Transformers
thing.
Or something.
Physically fused together?
I think it's more like his spirit gets fused into Greninja and it's
when their powers combine and all that.
Yeah. So no, it's pretty bonkers in the series now, but the games are a bit more balanced in a sense.
Right. You could make an argument, actually. You know, a lot of people have made the argument that the Pokemon games themselves have not changed enough. You know, the main gameplay is essentially the same, And the really big shift only started to happen recently in terms of graphics, and that they've become kind of fully 3D now in the last last few installments. And
is it
they're
still
making
all
even
like
more
turn
changes.
Based?
Yeah, it's still basically the same. Yeah.
Same. It's still the same. You get four
it's
attacks.
It's more or less the same. Everything like that. The only thing that's kind of changing now is like they're introducing stuff like Mega Evolutions, and now this in the new one that's coming out in like a month, C moves, which makes like you can have a special extra strong move once in a while. But yeah, there was the first four generations of the games were pretty much stuck in the same rut for a long while, and then it was actually first when Black and White came out that they started focusing on story being much more immersive, like you having actually a choice of what you want to say to your antagonist and stuff like that. We get more out of the story, and it's not a straightforward you against a villain of some sort that wants to change the world or make an apocalypse or something like that. It's more like you and a sad antagonist, not really a true antagonist, someone you can actually relate to and maybe sympathize with. So
both trying to become like the top of the dog fighting community.
Yeah, it's essentially by getting the largest and most ferocious dog.
Is the series still as popular as it was in the 90s? Because it just seemed like crazy at one point. Like when it first
even more
began.
So now.
Well, so for a long time, no. For a long time, it was on the decline, but this year has been the huge resurgence.
I guess it's...
They've always had the card game or something, right? Like, they've always kind of been around, just not as much in the public consciousness as they have been since the app came out.
Yeah, I remember the card game.
Well, actually...
They had to ban it at primary school because kids were just playing it constantly in class. It was huge. Like, and there was, like, conventions or functions at supermarkets where you could go and download secret Pokemon. There was, like, machines at Blockbuster where you could print out your photos from Pokemon Snap.
Yeah, well,
Pokemon Snap
still do all that.
I love Pokemon Snap. It's probably my favorite of the Pokemon games. It's so fun.
Wasn't it, like, on the N64, you'd just go take pictures, right?
Yeah, you're on a track, and you're going through various environments, like volcanoes and... seas and caves, and you just see them playing around, and you can change the environment by playing music and throwing food at them and stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I think the Game Freak who produces it and Pokemon Company has just been better at promoting and doing something new, mixing up the game, because the trading card game is also a lot different from what it was to begin with.
I remember I had that holographic Charizard that was worth $50. I had one of those, but I lost it.
Yeah.
And I checked it on eBay. It's worth $4,000 now.
Yeah, and that's the most valuable card in the game. Yeah. Damn.
And wasn't there the Mew character? Like, that wasn't originally part of the game, but they left a bit of code in there, and you could add it later. Like.
I'm gonna sometime do a Pokemon cast, but it was put in more like a joke or an Easter egg for himself, because it wasn't actually meant that you were able to get to it. You kind of actually have to hack the game, sort of. So yeah, it was just one of the character creators. He made his own little character and put it in.
And there was also like some Pokemon you could only get in blue, some in red, so you'd have to trade them between. Like, it was just amazing marketing drive.
Yeah.
Like, they got so many toys.
The whole you have to catch them all thing. It's like, come on, you got to get them. Like, regardless, you got to keep playing until you get them. Oh, but you can't. Like, number one, you can't get all three starters unless you just screw around. And there's like what 20 in each that you couldn't get, which was supposed to encourage trading, I guess. But
yes.
Yeah. See, the whole point by Satoshi Tajiri, he came up with the idea when he was working at this company, and because he had a really large passion as a child for collecting bugs. And the whole thing about it in Japan, you collected bugs and you would trade them with each other. So if you found one specific bug, it was really, you can maybe trade it for another. And he wanted the games to be also very communal and very social. Even though you're just playing on your own handheld, you can trade with other people and meet them randomly and just say, hey,
pre-online gaming, really, too. So you had to actually find people.
And also, the way they made the first game, it utilized the memory on the cartridge, which was very limited at the time, to do something that was never seen before. I mean, there's so many feats of engineering on that in that game that they don't even realize.
So we need a Pokemon VOC and we need a 90s nostalgia VOC. Yeah. It's like it's being planned in the
idea. Right. We're having our That's Digimon
preview,
sidebar in the chat.
The Pokemon.
Good stuff. Okay. All right. Well, we might click onto the next person. Paul, would you like to tell us about your second game?
All right. My second game is the recent Blizzard release, Overwatch, which is a very fun team shooter. Many will say that it is basically a TF2 clone, but they are wrong. That's all. That's the evidence I need. And it's basically you play a variety of fun characters, each going into one of four classes. You have offensive characters who flank and do damage, defensive characters who can hold a point and do damage, tanks who take up the damage, and healers who get rid of the damage, or support, because Symmetra counts as support, but she doesn't heal. And it's basically each character kind of has their own little personality you play with. For instance, you have Junkrat and Roadhog, who are two Australians, because in this time, Australia is a barren wasteland like in Mad Max. And
they're basically Mad Max characters.
Wait, what?
They're like, what are Australians famous for? Living in a post-apocalyptic wasteland. Yeah. All right, yeah, sure. We'll go with that. And,
Now I should check this game out.
Yeah, they each have their own kind of personality. You have the basic engineer who built a turret named Torbjorn, and one of his rays is just an IKEA instruction manual for building his turret.
Or the Swedish chef.
Well. They also have him as the Swedish chef as one of his tags. He can just post on the map. You have the French assassin Widowmaker, the cheery Brit Tracer, and of course the all-American McCree, who's a cowboy who is just a major badass. And you can get skins for him. Gameplay wise, it's very fun. Like, you can pick it up kind of and find what kind of character you're more attuned to. If you're into sniping, you can pick Hanzo or Widowmaker. If you prefer barreling into people and crushing them with a hammer, you can pick Reinhardt. Or if you just like shooting bombs everywhere without really knowing where they're going, you can always play as Junkrat. So yeah, it's since it's very new, they're constantly adding new things. They have events because they're Blizzard, much like you would have in like World of Warcraft or something like that. When the Summer Olympic Games were going on, they had a special gameplay style you could play called Lucio Ball, which was basically just soccer. And you can get skins for them and emotes and all this cosmetic stuff. But if you pay $60 up front for the game, you get basically everything. You don't have to pay for DLC after that when they keep adding it. And they're constantly adding more characters to play as well. So,
yeah, I love this game as well. Yeah, who's your favorite, Paul?
My favorite? Recently, when I started, I liked playing Junkrat because he's crazy and like just yells in his Australian accent all these sorts of crazy things. And I just kind of like the just randomness of the way his bombs can be just shot out and you can lay like a bear trap to crush people. But a favorite? I'm not sure. It depends how my team is doing, because usually I'm salty as fuck whenever I'm playing that.
It's a competitive game. Yeah.
It is a competitive game, and unlike in TF2, where a single player can sometimes just turn the tide, if your team isn't doing enough to help you out, you can get very angry really quick, like I do very often.
Like when I play with you?
I'm just glad we're not using voice chat when we're playing, because you'll just start hearing all sorts of explicatives coming from my mouth. I think I've started to like playing Hanzo the best with his bow and arrow and the way you can just snipe people.
Yeah, my favorite when the game first came out was Symmetra. I just loved making the turrets and making people really mad, but people eventually figured out how to deal with that. I'm playing Ana a lot. She's the newest character. She wasn't in the game originally. She's the first like new person that they added. And she is this awesome, badass old lady who shoots people that are allies with her sniper rifle to heal them. She heals with her sniper rifle. It's the most amazing fun thing ever, and I really enjoy it. I will say, like, I really enjoyed this game, and I was really looking forward to it, and I still, like, love it. But I don't think, for me, it's reached the same heights as TF2 in terms of what it's capable of. Like, I just had so many weird experiences in TF2 that I don't think that Overwatch is capable of. Like, the gameplay is fun, but it feels like at some point there isn't nearly as much depth in there as some other games. Like, the characters do their thing, and you learn it, and it feels like to a point it gets sort of stale.
I think it's because TF2, you were always able to kind of modify it to your specifications. Like, you could make a map with people, and you can, like, the community was a lot better with TF2. But because Blizzard likes to kind of keep their things contained, you're probably not going to get the kind of detail the community had in.
Like, all the mods and maps and game modes, you're not going to get
that. But you are seeing, like, the fans really loving these very specific characters. Just, like, what everyone always says is, like, oh, my God, the characters are so diverse. But it's true. They are – there's a lot for everyone. You can play May, who's a chubby scientist who freezes people and then looks them in the eyes as she shoots an icicle straight
Satan
into their
herself.
Head. She is Satan, basically. Yeah. Not much, but
yeah.
So China,
yeah, that was my
China.
Right. Yeah. That was my caveat, is that the characters are all really interesting, and one of the most impressive things about this game is not the game itself, but all the ancillary content they're putting out adjacent to it. You know, they have all these comics and even these like Pixar-like animations they're fantastic. Like, even if you don't want to play the game, you just go watch these and you'll love them. They did one recently with the character Bastion, who's a turret, basically a robot, and he has more emotion than any of the other characters combined, and he doesn't say a word. So they're really impressive, and they're doing a great job just giving the characters more and more lore and backstory outside of the game.
For a whole month, you cannot go anywhere in Tumblr without bumping into something Overwatch-related.
Yeah, it's taken over.
Good or bad.
And, well, always be careful when you go up, look, because whenever, it's rule 34, basically,
yeah,
where if someone likes a character enough, there will be porn of them. And
I
learned this mistake when my mother was, she's like, oh, what game is that? I'm like, oh, Overwatch. I'm like, oh, let me show you some of the characters. And I just Google them. And then there's Widowmaker and Tracer having sex on a pile of money. And my mother's like, oh, that's pleasant. And I'm like, no, it's a lot more than just porn.
It's only one part.
That's a major facet. That's a major facet, but there's much more going on.
All right. Adam, would you like to tell us about your second game?
Yeah, so Shadow of the Colossus is a PlayStation 2 game that was released in 2005. And it was very different from anything, especially on consoles, that we'd had kind of up to that point. Well, I guess there was kind of one similarity. But yeah, it's basically they took a game where it's almost nothing but, you know, boss battles. There's not really a lot else to do in the game. There's just a lot of roaming around. But it's just a really beautiful world. All of the colossi are beautifully rendered and designed. The lighting, the soundtrack, just kind of everything about it. I think it's one of the earlier games that kind of got people thinking as video games with, like, artistic merit, whereas, you know, your Marios and stuff for years, they kind of dismissed that, and then as technology's gotten on, like, that argument's become, I think, a lot more into the fold. But, yeah, I remember when the game came out, everyone said, oh, you gotta play it, and, I mean, it was, you know, I paid one of the few games, I'll pay full price for it, and knowing that, you know, it wasn't gonna be a game that I played for, you know, 50 hours or whatever, but, you know, it was well worth the experience, and something I've come back to over and over again.
Yeah, this is one of my favorite games as well, and I think just, like, from the point of view of atmosphere, I can't think of any game that is more just drenched in atmosphere as this game, and it feels so lonely and desolate, and but at the same time really beautiful, because there's the environments are very huge and detailed, but there's just nothing. There's like snakes, maybe lizards, and maybe like a bird every now and then, but it's just you and your horse and this spirit that you make a Faustian deal with at the beginning of the game, and then these 12 lumbering colossi that you have to figure out how to kill, and each one is unique in its approach and how you go after it. Some of them are big and lumbering and don't even really care about you. And some of them are vicious and extremely aggressive, and some are a little small, and others you have to actually climb up. It's just each one is just designed really intricately, and in getting to the Colossi is sometimes kind of a puzzle in itself, but it's always really an awesome moment when you arrive to the battle area and that Colossus comes out and you're like, okay, do I climb up this one? Do I have to lure it into a part of the environment? Or, you know, is it shooting stuff at me? Does that mean I have to get behind a rock? Like, it's just really cool. And I love how minimalist the story is of this really misguided hero who has one motive, and that is to bring back this girl from the dead. And the only way he can do that is by potentially doing the worst thing imaginable. Like, the whole story is just really tense with the idea that there is a terrible price that is going to be paid for all of this. It's just awesome.
And I think that part of, like, the world being very sparse, I mean, you're in, like, the Forbidden Land and all that. I mean, it's very well designed, obviously, but I also think that was part of the limitations of the technology that forced them into that a little bit, you know, because they really wanted to focus on the Colossi and those battles. And so they had to find a way to make the world kind of interesting, but also not have a lot in it. And I think they did a really good job.
Yeah, this is another game I'm like a third of the way through and got distracted by something else, to my shame. But I do remember enjoying it a lot. And like, the atmosphere is great. It has almost like this Greek sort of myth feel to it, where you're wading into the underworld or you're fighting these titanic gods or something. It is a very beautiful game, just riding on and on into this very desolate, dreary horizon. And the one criticism I had was I did find the controls a bit tricky, a bit sort of unresponsive. So you'll be climbing up a boss and you'll be hitting the right thing, but it's not quite connecting. But I don't know, maybe that's just because I'm playing the HD sort of upgrade, so maybe you need to play the PS2 version.
Who's the H?
Sorry.
H spotting. Sorry. Carry on.
I think that, I guess I've played it so many times that I guess I'm used to it, but there is a very frustrating element every now and then, because some of the climbing mechanics do take a long time. Like, if you're climbing up this giant monster and it takes you a few minutes to get the top, there's something very frustrating on, like, your grip meter is not communicating to you clearly enough, like when you're about to be dropped or just falling. And it can be a little, like, there's a few of the Colossi that are just like a slog to get through. But I don't know. I never found it like overly sticky. I always thought the horse especially rode really well. That was the other one I was going to talk about, is, you know, a game that lets me ride a horse around. So I'm already in the pocket.
Always good. Yeah. I heard, like, with the HD PS Now version, there were some bugs even with the controls, but hopefully they fixed that at this point.
Has anyone played Eco?
Nay.
Same. A little bit.
No.
Videos. Like, I had a friend who had the game, and, like, a couple times we played it, but I never bought it.
Well, if you like Shadow of the Colossus, like, Eco is very different, but it's the same thing of, like, there's very limited combat in Eco. It's much more puzzly, but it's the idea of being in a very lonely, haunted place, and there not being almost any dialogue, and it just being mostly about the atmosphere of trying to escape.
All right, we might move on. Speaking of horses in vast plains, I might go on to my pick.
So wonder what it is. Wonder.
My pick is super cliched, but I feel like someone had to mention it. It's an action-adventure game by Nintendo, released in 1998 for the Nintendo 64, and it is called The Legend of Zelda Ocarina of Time. Surprise. And it was the first free-roaming 3D game in the Zelda series, and to me it's just one of the most epic fantasy experiences of all time. The first time you creep out of your woodland home and lay eyes upon the plains of Hyrule Field, you get a sense of just the endless possibilities of the 3D world. You can spot mountains and castles in the far distance and actually travel there by foot. And yeah, it's this quintessential hero's journey. It mixes epic storytelling, sword and aerial combat, puzzle solving, exploration, fetch quests, and magic. And I think what's brilliant about the game is how the entire world exists completely independent of your mission. So you can just wander into a village and chat with various locals. You can help them complete various tasks for rewards. You can buy and sell things. You can search underground hidden caves for treasure. You can gamble. And you can even go fishing. The game is packed with memorable and jaw-dropping moments, but my favorite has to be about a third of the way through the game's runtime. And I guess this is kind of a spoiler, but it's a pretty old game. But the fun hero's journey that you've been valiantly completing up until then suddenly comes crashing down. You get frozen in time and you wake up 7 years later to find that the princess you were tasked with saving has vanished and the Dark Lord you were tasked with defeating has conquered the world. And yeah, it's this cool sort of transition into adulthood, I guess, this dark, scary contrast with the happy first half of the game. And so, yeah, you wander through the same world, but now there's apocalyptic storm clouds. A lot of the townships are all ruined and abandoned and crawling with monsters. And I just think it's a really cool twist. And also the gameplay design of being able to learn about the future and then change things in the past to alter the world around you, I thought was really brilliant. And it manages to add this sort of fourth dimension to this already really deep world. And like Donkey Kong Country, I think the music is incredible and really memorable. Like even today, I'll find myself humming various themes like the Lost Woods theme. And yeah, it's also integrated. The music's integrated really well into the gameplay via your ocarina, so you can actually alter the world by playing music. And it's a pretty obvious choice, but I think it still holds up today.
Like we've all played, everyone here has played it, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. No.
Yep.
No, nope. Someone?
Well, who hasn't?
Oh, me. Patrick.
Shame.
No,
shame.
I just didn't really ever get into the Zelda things. I tried. I really tried, but it's just the first one was really boring.
They're all different.
Like the NES one? Or like
yeah,
yeah. I mean, I just tried to get into the series. I don't, but since then, I've just not.
Well, so Ocarina of Time represents a huge shift in what the games are like from those original Legend of Zelda. Like, it's a hugely different game.
I mean, maybe. I mean, same as with, like, Prince of Persia and stuff like that. But, I mean, I just like to play stuff from the beginning to the end. I mean,
well, it doesn't matter. Like, well, there's not really a through line. It's more like just the same game being remade over and over again with different ideas. So it's not. I mean, I guess there is technically a continuation from.
There's a whole timeline now, kind of.
Yeah.
But
it's like a myth. It's like the same fairy tale.
You get Link and you get Zelda in every game.
Maybe. I don't know.
And I'll say for me too. I don't love Ocarina of Time as someone who played it kind of after its heyday. Like, I don't love it as a game, that sort of Zelda puzzle mechanic. Like, it doesn't get me as much as some people. I think it's a very important game, and I did enjoy it, like, a lot. Like, it's still a fantastic game, but it's not, like, one of my favorite games. The part I love about it is all the stuff that's come around it. Like, you know, if anyone knows what speedrunning is, it's a huge game in that community where, you know, it's a games where you have to beat as fast as possible. And Ocarina of Time is, like, kind of like the game that's held up as the best in that, because there's so many different things you can do in that game. There's so many different weird glitches that can completely change the experience. And there's, like, all kinds of these different things that have stacked up on it that have made it so interesting.
Yeah, that's the other thing I love about it. It is so full of, like, secrets. Like, I remember playing as a kid. My best friend was playing it at the same time, and we would, like, ring each other when we found, like, secret caves. There was all folklore about somewhere you could find the Triforce somewhere in the game. And it was just such a... Because it was one of the first big free-roaming 3D games, there was this sense it would just keep going on and on. Like, you could see mountains in the distance and actually go there. Like, it was this fully realized world, and you just wanted to explore all of it. So it just cultivated that sense of mystery.
Yeah. I feel like for a lot of people, it was very formulative. And I can remember when my best friend in fourth grade, she got it and going over to her house and just being like in awe of what seemed so different from any other games that I'd play. Cause up until then, like most games that I'd played on, you know, Super Nintendo or Sega Saturn were rail shooters or platformers. And the idea of this giant fantasy world that's like, in my mind, it was like reading a fantasy book, but you actually get the experience of doing it yourself. It was just amazing. And I remember just like long after I beat that game, just running around and inventing my own stories in my head. And like you said, Duncan, like trying to find the tiniest little secrets. Like I was haunted for years by the thought that there was I had heard the rumor that there was the sinking lure was somewhere in the game, and I was never able to find it to catch the big fish in the middle of the pond. And that drove me bonkers because I was like, it has to be out there. Like people are talking about the sinking lure, but like it just seemed possible that something like that would exist in the game that you couldn't really find, or maybe you could if you tried hard enough.
And the other thing I wanted to mention was the passage of time is so visceral. Like you feel like it's such a big epic adventure that you like your perception of the world changes over time. Like you'll go back and visit old towns and old villages, like especially when you go back to your homeland, and it feels so different. It has like this, I don't know, Peter Pan quality to it, like you're a grown up but you're going back to this childhood place.
Yeah, it's really sad. You visit all these different places, and I mean, even just having the sunrise and like, you know, the sunset was, I don't know if any game had really even done that, certainly not in kind of that open world sense. So, you know, you had a both kind of a macro and a micro passage of time going on.
It was very sad, like the sense of this, like the tone I think they were going for was in a sense lost, and there was this really sad, irksome thing in that nobody recognized you, and for whatever reason, Link never told them, hey, it's me. And so going back to the Lost Woods, people, like, everyone would be like, wow, you seem so familiar. And it's like, just fucking tell them. Like, it's me. I've got the same fairy. Come on.
I love it, though. It is that character that's just a blank slate that you project yourself on. But there is, like, a sense that you're sort of, you don't exist in any one place because you're not from the past, you're not from the future. You're kind of just this lone figure. It's you and Zelda kind of only know what's really going on. It's you against the world. So I like that sense of not really belonging in any one place. There is a... I love the contrast between the adult and the childhood, because the childhood feels so fun, but the adulthood feels so dark. And you go back to these seemingly fun places, like even a place like Kakariko Village, which is nice, but then you travel underneath it to the Shadow Temple, which is just this nightmarish hellscape, and there's things written on the walls like the sins of the village are coming back to haunt you. You go on ghost ships. It's so cool.
Yeah. How did you feel about Majora's Mask, Duncan?
I loved it. It's a very different game, but I think it leaned even more into that apocalyptic vibe. And I thought the mechanics were even more sophisticated. Sort of mapping out a 3-day span and every little inch of a world and all the way that a whole world interconnects with each other. And the villain was even more interesting, I thought, in the second one. Feelings of isolation and loneliness, which I guess you could see reflected in yourself.
Yeah, I played Ocarina a lot more, but I think I preferred Majora's Mask. It's way darker and kind of sinister and much sadder.
Yeah, it's a much bolder, more experimental game, so you got to respect it for that.
Yeah, and I think Majora's Mask was not nearly as popular for a number of reasons, but didn't it require like the expansion memory or whatever?
Yes.
To play, and that was like a lot of people just didn't do that. So I remember having that, and a lot of people were like, so you had to spend an extra like $30 or whatever to get that.
The mask mechanic in general was just dark as shit. I remember even like as a kid, I was like, this is really creepy, where it's like you play the song of healing for people and it kills them because they long for death. And then you take their skin that turns into a mask and you become them and you go talk to their family and their family thinks you're them.
And there's even darker stories buried in that game that they don't explicitly state. But if you really think about it, there's so much stuff happening there.
You reckon George R. Martin was playing it when he was coming up with the House in Black and White?
Could be.
All right, so we're almost at 3 hours. Do we want to do maybe a to be continued, and we can go through some of our other choices in a follow-up episode?
That seems like a good idea to me. But
Yeah, because either we'd do that or we'd have to just kind of quick wrap it up with like
I like being able to discuss a little, you know, 10 minutes per game. I like that. So we don't want to race through it too much.
Yeah.
All right, so we got through 2 rounds, so we can maybe get through the other 3 in a future one. There's a couple of concluding questions, thoughts on the current gen, things like that. As I said, I haven't really played much of this gen, but did anyone have any thoughts on that?
I think that games can do more than ever, but there are less games than ever that interest me in a way, I guess. Yeah. Just because a lot of them, I'm like, oh, well, I've done that 10 times now. You know, like I'm looking for something that's unique or that does something I really like in a unique way. I don't know. And just that it's time, too, obviously. But you find yourself getting, like, I still get sucked into, like, oh, I can just play 20 minutes of, you know, Call of Duty or, you know, whatever random thing and then just be done. And, you know, I don't have to worry if I don't get back to it for 6 months or something.
Yeah. I think The Witcher 3 took me a year or like something in my mind. I feel like it took me a year. It was probably much shorter than that, but I was like, I feel like, you know, if this was 10, 15 years ago, I would have burned through this in maybe a week or so. But now it's like, it got old. So now it has to stretch out across infinite time.
And then when you come back to it, you have to like reorient yourself to what is going on.
Man, this is sad, like Ocarina of Time. Got real.
Got real.
Oh, yeah. I mean, the current gen, I think, is on the precipice on being more like, you know, how games have gone more into being episodic and DLC and stuff like that. I think consoles and stuff like that is going the same way. It's going to be either expansions or marginal increases in power or whatever from now on, with it kind of going the same way as PCs, essentially, that you, in a modular, more modular way, can improve on your console or your gaming experience than before. We had to wait like 8 years and then get a console that was very much better than the one before it.
Yeah, we're already seeing that with new versions of the Xbox One and the PlayStation 4 that are coming out shortly. So they're already doing that sort of more rapid increase in quality, but it's not quite as dramatic or quite as much of a paradigm shift than what came before.
The thing is, I think we're also approaching a singularity in that sense, because we're so close to getting like realistic graphics that any increase in that will not feel as big of an improvement as, the, for example, the jump from 2D to 3D, or the amount of polygons that was from a, like a PlayStation 1 to a PlayStation 2.
How many bits is it?
Yeah, exactly. How many bits? We don't even measure our consoles in that anymore.
It's not even a thing anymore.
Well, in terms of in terms of new technologies, has anyone tried the Oculus Rift? Do you think it has any application for gaming long term?
As an application for porn long term.
Yeah. I mean, I think obviously VR, even for gaming and for porn, is the future eventually. I haven't tried the Oculus Rift or the HTC Vive. I've used like the Gear VR and like the Google Cardboard, like the lesser quality stuff. And like you can, I mean, it's not there yet, clearly. Like, it's not to the point where it feels like we're going to have that shift. But, you know, I think that's where it's inevitably going once we get the technology that's both, you know, good enough to give us a truly great simulated experience and also cheap enough that people can widely buy it.
Yeah, that's the cost aspect of it is, I mean, if you're trying to sell units, people have to be able to afford it. You know, like HD content wasn't really a big deal until HD TVs were cheap enough that people were, you know, starting to switch, you know, people that didn't have six-figure incomes.
Yeah, well, there's also, as I can see in the comments in the chat section, there's also the whole thing that we need porn to back it in a major
porn
way.
Porn needs to spend that money.
Yeah, essentially, because every single technology jump we've had, where we had a few choices, it's essentially decided by the porn industry. Except for Blu-ray, but VHS and whatever, yeah, it was like a lot of stuff, like just streaming it.
They're like the early adopters of a lot of that stuff, you mean?
Yeah. Same thing with stuff like online streaming, video streaming, that was really put forth in a major way by the porn industry. So a lot of the things.
Well, I think we're reaching a bit of a critical mass just for media in general, with the amount of content that is, you know, like pirating, of course, but the amount of content that is free or very cheap, and kind of people's expectations of like their dollar, their entertainment dollar, how far it goes. Like movie theaters, video games, porn, whatever, like they need to offer a unique experience to get people to pay a premium for it. And so that's why they're pushing, you know, like 3D in movie theaters, they pushed that for a while. And then, you know, VR, if they can make this affordable, you know, they've got to push something to make the experience, you know, worth you paying for.
But yeah, it's the same thing, same notion that's also kind of the killer of the standard MMO RPG, that you're not really prepared to pay $15 a month or whatever it is for something that doesn't, like, wow you every time you play it.
Yeah, like all those are like largely going like free, right? And then like microtransactions, and because they want to get you to, like, just get you playing, because like they get people feeling that the playing is not the part that you're paying for. You need to be paying for like the uniqueness,
cosmetics and stuff.
Yeah,
looking cool.
But I think, I don't know, like this holiday season, I'll probably get a PS4 or a Xbox One at some point. You know?
Yeah. I don't
know. I just, you know, I have so much stuff from the last generation that I'm, you know, that I really want to get through, like, and like really good quality games, but stuff like I haven't played Dragon Age Inquisition yet. Like, there are a number of games that I'm like, oh, yeah, I need to upgrade to to play properly, like Shadow of Mordor, same thing.
Yeah, I'm not going to buy a new console. Maybe the NX, because I have a really good PC, and I love that one. And if I want something different, it's usually on consoles, I usually just play like a Mario Party or Mario Kart or whatever like that. So it kind of fills the last sort of empty space I have in my gaming world. So yeah, I'll just stick with PC, and then I have a Wii U on the, or an NX on the side.
Yeah, I would just say as far as games go, in this new generation, if that's marked by like the release of the PS4 and the Xbox One, I don't think there's any game for me that's like been defining so far and really like really exciting. Like, there's games I've enjoyed. Have you guys like seen anything that really like you thought was like super awesome in this gen?
I think the problem is a lot of these games are getting overhyped.
True. Very true.
Oh yeah, No Man's Sky. Yeah, that was
I was
good point.
Genre defining right
it's
there.
It's hard to
right.
go to a gaming podcast without having to talk about No Man's Sky. But and the problem is like No Man's Sky, if it just really actually was a like indie release to little fanfare, a lot of people might have actually enjoyed it. But then it became this, and then people have expectations of what games should be rather than what they are now. And it's leading me towards going to more indie games and such like that because of that. Just
I'm still waiting for like my game, you know? Yeah. I'm still waiting for like, you know, the Grand Theft Auto where I can go in every building, in every room, where it's just like a map of an actual like city block somewhere, you know? Like that's what, you know, one day it'll be that way, and then it's just like, you know, it's basically reality at that point. Like
end of gaming.
Yeah. Like where do you go from there?
Yeah, true open world Vampire Bloodlines. That's what I'm looking for.
That's the ultimate end of gaming.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah, like you know, a game where it's like you can literally do whatever you want.
Yeah.
You know, create your own story, go anywhere, do anything. And it's just, that's, you know, I imagine in the future you could definitely see that as, you know, instead of all these AAA titles being released, you have maybe two or three competing, like, mega games that are, you know, constantly supported, you know, constantly coming out with new content that, like, everyone just plays this, and that's what you're always playing, and it's always being updated, and, like, there's not new games coming out.
What dystopian universe is this?
No, but I mean, like, but I mean, not necessarily something like it's just like The Sims or something. But I mean, like, you know, in this world, if you wanted to play a police drama, or if you wanted to play, you know, like, you know, I don't know, like, you know, vampires, or you know, like, whatever. Like, I'm just saying, like, it's the sort of thing where they'll make games that just kind of do whatever they want.
But it would sort of wreck the idea of like the individual vision of an artist or something if it was just generic tropes sort of
it would.
Together.
The future is dark and bleak. Let's end
Yay.
On that.
Yep. And filled with vampires.
Filled with vampires.
Hopefully.
Next time on video games.
Next time on video games. I like that.
To be continued.
Yeah, I enjoyed this.
All right.
Yeah, this was fun. Thank you for organizing, Duncan.
Yeah, thank you.
Sorry to keep cutting out. I'll just do an outro. So that concludes our video game roundtable. Please let us know what you think of our picks and also what your favorite games are. We'll reconvene at a later date for the rest of the rounds. I'd like to thank our hosts for this evening, including Paul, Bing, Patrick, Zach, Katie, and Adam. This has been the Vassals of Kingsgrave. Thanks for listening, and we'll catch you next time.
And Hannah.
And Hannah.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Bye. Bye.